bezkut Eliyahu, Hanavi Avena, El Eliyahu, El Eliyahu, bezkut Eliyahu, Hanavi Avena, Hamalach HaGoel, Ifne Dal Soel, Ana HaEl, Abraham Akrena, El Eliyahu, El Eliyahu, בזכות אליהו, הנביא הבנה, רב מחלי בראות, כך שיום סנאות, יפות ובריאות, בסרוות קרענה, אל אליהו, אל אליהו, בזכות אליהו, הנביא הבנה, יהי שלום בחילנו, יהי שלום בחילנו, ושלווה בישראל, בסימן טוב, בין בא לנו, בימה, יבוא הגואל. Amen, amen, ve'simanto ben balanu ve'yama ve'yavohar Adezikina ve'gam seva, adezikina ve'gam seva Yei dashen bechol tova, shalom lo ve'robava Amen, ken yohoma, ha'el amen, amen ve'simanto ben balanu ve'yama ve'yavohar Ukoro yehibar, ukoro yehibar Yehibau, zeman hayyam ye'i'au, ve'shulhano ye'i'au, ve'zivacho lo'it. Jain, amen, 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 besimanto, ben balalu, be'yama, yavo ha'go.
אז נגיד שני מילים.
שבו את כולם, אבא. אבא, תגיד לכולם שיבואו.
חבר'ה, בואו לפה, בואו.
כמה מילים לכבוד... לכבוד אחר כנסים בשבוע. מי שברך, מי שברך... מי שברך אמותינו שרה רבקה חן ובגלת ושרה מכה הוא יברך בשמו את מימרת אמי ג'ולת של חב"ד מסעודה אל נא רפן עלה אל נא רפן עלה
רבנה
מבריה ושל תפועת הגוף שתזכה לקבל את המשיח בעזרת השם רפואה שלמה, פרנסה טובה בעזרת השם שיתרפא לה הרגל בעזרת השם, אמן אמן, רפואה שלמה, כל הישועות בעזרת השם בזכות הרב יצחק כדורי בית יפחה בעזרת השם בזכות אליהו הנביא מלאך הברית אין הרפן עלה, אין הרפן עלה ברנה ובריה וסגידיה ג'ולי צל חב"ד מסעודה ואין לי רצות ונאמר אמן נקל רוצה להגיד אמן, שימלא את כל משאלות דיבה לטובה של מרת
אמי,
ג'ולי צל חב"ד מסעודה, בעזרת השם, ותזכה לראות את אליהו, את ביאת המשיח, לקבל את המשיח, בעזרת השם, בקרוב, בעזרת השם, בשנה הזאת, אינשאללה, אמן. אין הרפן עלה, אין הרפן עלה, ברנה בבריה, ושסג ידי הרפואת הנפש, רפואת הגוף. אבי הבן רוצה להגיד לך משהו, אמא.
שלום עליכם, שהקדוש ברוך הוא יברך אתכם, ייתן לכם חיים ארוכים, שלמים, מלאים תורה, מצוות, וחסדים, אשריכם על הבן הצדיק שלך, הבנים הצדיקים שלך, שהקדוש ברוך הוא יברך אתכם, ובעזרת השם, ונראה אתכם בהגיעת משיח בעזרת השם.
אמן, אמן. אמן, נגיד כמה מילים, כמה דברי תורה, אומרים חייבים, אומרים חייבים לדבר בשבח האכסניה, קודם כל, ככה גמרא אומרת, בכמה מקומות בתלמוד, כמו שאמרנו, I try to speak English. בעזרת השם, כמו שהגמרא אומרת שם בברכות סמ"ג עמוד ב', אני רוצה לומר שוב פעם ושוב פעם, we don't have too much, הלוואי, if we have, I think, a few family like family ראובן, זה משיח coming here, I don't know if it's coming in ירושלים, big צדיקים, בעלי חסד, בגופם, בממונם, ממש אנשים, איך אומרים, איך הגמרא אומרת, כמה שאתה רואה את גדולתו של הקדוש ברוך הוא, אתה רואה את ענוותנותו. ככה הגמרא אומרת שצריכים ללמוד מהמידות של הקדוש ברוך הוא. כל רחום וחנון, כתוב, כל זמן שעם ישראל עושים כמו 13 מידות, כך הקדוש ברוך הוא, כאילו, מה זה עושים? We making? We say, כל רחום וחנון, ערך אפיים, מה זה כל זמן שעושים? We making? באמת המפרשים אומרים, yes, כן. עושים את כמו הקדוש ברוך הוא. מה הקדוש ברוך הוא רחום? He's help everybody, we must help אחד השני, one from another. אם הקדוש ברוך הוא סולח, צריך גם אנחנו לסלוח. נו,
חד ושלום.
בדיוק. אז אומר, כל זמן שישראל עושים לפניי כסדר הזה, אני מוחה להם על כל עוונותיהם. ככה גמרא אומרת במסכת ראש השנה דף י"ז עמוד ב', התוספות שם מעריכים עניין של 13 מידות. מה זה 13 מידות? יש מחלוקת בין הפשט לקבלה, אם השם השם זה מידה או זה לא מידה. על פי הסוד, לפי הסוד זה כל מתחיל מכל, אבל לפי הפשט השם השם זה גם מידה. למה פעם עם השם השם? אני השם בפור שאדם עשה חטא, בפור זה זמק סינס, לא? אני השם after the sins. Even if somebody makes sins, חס ושלום, עוונות, הקדוש ברוך הוא מוחל לו לעוונות. ובפרט, באמת שאלו אותי, באמת, הסבא של הבייבי, השם ישמור אותו, רבי דוד ראובן, הוא שאל אותי, עניין מה סגולה להיות בברית מילה? אז אומרים, הקדוש ברוך הוא אמר לי, אליהו הנביא, you must to know, בגלל שאתה דיברת על לשון הרע על עם ישראל, אמרת, עברו בריתך, עם ישראל מת, חס ושלום, סינס, חייך, שאתה, you must to go, אין לי ברית מילה. אני אעשה אליהו הנביא, how I can to come in, אין לי ברית מילה. Every people, the חס ושלום, no keep all the מצוות, no, חס ושלום, I don't want to go, אין לי ברית מילה. השם אמר לו, no, if somebody coming לברית מילה, אני מוחל לו לעוונות.
Forgive him all the sins.
Forgive him all the sins. אז צריך לדעת מי שבא לברית מילה. לכן, if you go in the Brooklyn, in שערי ציון, if you invited 100 people, you see 300 people. Who is coming? Free. The people coming free. למה? Why?
Free food.
אם היו יודעים, free food. למה? למה? צריך לדעת. אומרים חס ושלום, אם somebody, מי שלא אוכל בברית מילה, חס ושלום יש עליו קפידה גם. צריך לדעת. צריך לדעת, זה סעודת מצווה. סעודת מצווה זה ראשי תיבות. סמך מם א' למד, אתם יודעים, זה ראשי תיבות של מלאך שהוא כאילו מהסתרה חרה. אז הוא אומר, סעודת מצווה, את סעודת מילה אין לעשות. הוא לא רוצה שיעשו סעודת מילה. כל כך זה גבוה. סעודת מילה, it's more the wedding. מחפים לו כל העוונות, דבר עצום. מחפים על זה, בפרט אבי הבן, שהוא מביא, עושה ברית מילה לבן שלו, שהוא כאילו מקריב את כל הקורבנות על גבי המזבח. כך הוא אומר, הזוהר הקדוש, כל כך זה מעלה גדולה לבוא לברית מילה, שנמחלים לבן אדם כל העוונות כולם. כן, הגמרא אומרת, אני רק אספר משהו. אומרים שהאדם בפרשת השבוע כתוב שכל אחד היה מביא כסף, money from the משכן. אז היה אחד, היה רב חני ולוז'ין, סטודנט דה אליהו מווינה, רבי הגאון, רבי אליהו מווינה. He's collect money every year. One time he was very old, he had more 80-90 years old. מה הוא עשה? הוא שלח את מי? את השמש. He said, please collect money. השמש, what is do? היה לקח סוסים, horses. אבל ילביש להם everything gold. Some, the belt, gold. The cover, the hat, gold. Everything gold. היה אחד שהסכיב from the ישיבה 50%. שהוא היה עובד בשדות, היה לו שדות, היה לו בהמות. הגמרא אומרת בהרבה מקומות בתלמוד שבעשתירות שונך, if somebody want to come be rich, מה הוא יעשה? יגדל את שיפ, יגדל בהמות. למה? זה לבד, הם מגדלים, הם נולדים לבד, ככה הגמרא אומרת. אז הוא בא אליו ואומר לו, this year does not have any sense. הוא אומר, every year you give me 50% the all the money, the ישיבה, you give me more than $100,000. This year you don't have any penny? הוא אומר, no, I don't have. He's got to beg the rabbi, the רבחמי ולוג'ה, he says, it's not worth giving me money. He says, it's not make money, nothing. Rabbi says, I know the problem, I go. He said, Rabbi, I don't give money from the horses. I don't give money from the gold. I won't give money for that. Like, Chacham Yaron Reuven, Shlit Hashem Yishmerehu. He's a, make, איך אומרים, מחזיר בתשובה, brings everybody from תשובה. From this I want, for the people study Torah, to make, איך אומרים, תשובה. No, for that, I from you, he's coming with the horses, with the gold. For that I know, give money. אמר לו, you know, גם היה בצלאל, מה זה בצלאל? הגמרא אומר במסכת ברכות נ"ה עמוד ב', בצלאל, בצלאל. שהיה יודע את בצלאל, מה היה יודע? לחבר אותיות שנבראו בהם שמיים וארץ. ככה היה יודע. השמיים וארץ, הקדוש ברוך הוא, במה ברא אותם? יידיש? אינגליש? מה? היברו, א' ב', have people asking. He said, no, Rabbi, I not speak Hebrew. הם יודעים עברית יותר טוב ממני, לא היברו בטר, מי בטר? רבי, אני לא מדבר עברית. הקדוש ברוך הוא ברא את העולם באותיות שנבראו א' ב', ניסה בצלאל, מה הוא היה יודע? היה יודע, מה היה יודע אם somebody give money from לשם שמיים, is put the money inside the Aharon הקודש. If somebody make only from shop, is put the money בחצר, outside. גם אני, I know you make לשם שמיים, all your money, I give from like חכם ירון ראובן, the bricks, it's people from the תשובה to study. He said, now I give double. If I give 100,000, I give 200,000. בעזרת השם, ישמע בעזרת השם בבית הזה, כל ססטון וכל שמחה בעזרת השם, כל עוד פיפול בעזרת השם, שנזכה תמיד, באמת, שנזכה שיהיה לנו הרבה כמו ירון גובר. וסימן טוב הוא, מזל טוב הוא, מזל טוב הוא, סימן טוב הוא, מזל טוב הוא, מזל טוב הוא, מזל טוב הוא, סימן טוב הוא, מזל טוב הוא, מזל טוב הוא, יהיה לנו, יהיה לנו. David Melech Israel, Hay Rekai, Hore Banim Levanecha, Shalom Al Israel, Hore Banim Levanecha, Shalom Al Israel.
בכבוד
הרב ירון, בכבוד, מחילה.
פשוט הרב, we'll say a couple of things, Baruch Hashem, we chose to name the little tzaddik Yosef. Why we name him Yosef? In the business of the business of Zikuya Rabin, when you do Kiruv, you get surprised because you meet people from all walks of life. You meet people that are not religious and don't really know much and don't really know the purpose of life, don't really know why they're alive. They work, they eat, they drink, they sleep. But you ask them, what's the point of life? They don't really know. And then you also, so you figure, okay, so you bring some Torah to their life and you add some purpose. But then after a while, you meet some other people. You meet some people that already have Torah but still are confused. They're not really sure what's the point, what's this. Even though they have Torah and mitzvah, it doesn't necessarily mean they have all the answers. There's a lot of people that go to yeshiva, but they finish yeshiva without knowing anything. They passed the test, but didn't learn anything, though. So you meet religious people, too. And you see that, in reality, there are different people from the religious world, from the non-religious world. Sometimes you also meet goyim that want to become Jews more than the Jews want to be Jews. It's amazing how the Gemara in Masechet Avodah Zarah, right at the end of the third page, 3-bit, talks about that before the Mashiach comes, there's going to be a lot of converts. A lot of people are going to want to convert to Judaism. A lot of people are going to want to be Jews. And it's amazing that many times you meet people that want to be Jews a lot more than Jewish people want to be Jews. Why? One reason is that when you look at things from the outside, you see the whole picture. But sometimes when you're inside, you don't really value it. Take it for granted. Like somebody owes you something. It's like, oh yeah, I was born Jewish. What's the big deal? You ask the goy that wants to be a Jew, is it a big deal to be a Jew? The goy will tell you, I'm willing to die for it. Why? He knows what's the big deal. He sees from the outside. So you get to meet religious people. You get to meet non-religious people. You get to meet goyim that want to be Jews. You get to meet people that want to become righteous Noahides. So you get to meet people from all walks of life. But one of the schuyot that we had is that early on, we first started about 4 or 5 years ago to do Zikui Rabim, do lectures. Is mamash b'siyata d'ishmaya, we decided to do a lecture about something that almost nobody in the English world wants to talk about, which is the sin of Gama Brit. The Shulchan Aruch says it's the worst sin in the entire Torah. The Zohar Kadosh says, person that doesn't do tshuva for wasting seed, אין לו חלק לעולם הבא. He's finished. He keeps Shabbat, he keeps Tarat Mishpat, he keeps everything else. He doesn't do Tikkun HaBrit, הלך עליו, finished. Everything else becomes worthless. All of his mitzvot go to the Sitra Achra Bar Minan. You see, the Chachamim talk about it. Scary. Scary. And today we have an addiction to Pgama Brit because most people don't know how bad it is. Somebody told me recently, out of the entire internet, one of the reasons why the internet became so popular, originally it was a project of the government. The government had internet. But how did it go? How did the internet go into home computers? Why did the home computer become? Because of pornography sites. That's what built the internet. And today there are more than 80 million, or maybe 800 million, doesn't, you know, just 10 difference. 80 million pornography sites. 80 million ways to lose Olam Haba. 80 million ways. Yetzara is working very hard. So much so that it says that Yetzara sometimes helps a person do mitzvot. Go put tefillin on, keep Shabbat, learn Torah, do chesed, do everything. Just make this one sin. Go to look at this website, think about bad things, Hashem Yerachem. Why? Because then all of those mitzvot go to him anyway. So he helps the person do mitzvot, so he could take everything. So we learn in the Gemara Masechet Sota that the details of the story of Yosef HaTzadik. After his brothers sold him, Yosef HaTzadik was a very, very beautiful person, one of the most beautiful people that ever lived. He was so beautiful that his skin was shining, like a shemesh, like a light. You see the light? His skin was shining like this. So much so that the women would throw something at him, throw their underwear, their shirts, their money, gold, throw anything, just pay attention to me. But he never did. He always looked on the floor. Always looked on the floor. Never looked at another woman. So Chamim say, wait a minute, when Eshet Potiphar, the wife of Potiphar, she was also one of the four most beautiful women in the world. She wasn't ugly. She wasn't like a Gibenet or something like that with a hunchback soldier. You know, she was beautiful. So how come Moshe, Yosef wasn't really, how did he pass the test? How did he pass the test? One of the Chachamim says, because Yosef, he never looked at her. He never looked, he tried not to look at her. Why? Because attraction is a two-way street. If they look at you, they get attracted. But if you look at them, you get attracted. And then the attraction grows even more. Which is one of the reasons why watching your eyes to make sure that you don't look at the places you're not allowed is one of the foundations to doing tshuva. One of the foundations to having a good marriage. One of the foundations of having a good life. Why? Because a person that doesn't watch their eyes and just looks at everything, like a dog, what happens? A woman walks around, it's not his wife, he looks at her. His wife says, yeah, but I'm over here. Why are you looking at her? Oh, no, no, I was just, I didn't mean to. Okay, next girl comes out, he looks at her too. And the waitress, and the this one, and the that one. By the time he finished taking a walk down the street with his wife feels, wait, are you married to all of them or me? He forgot his wife is next to him. The person doesn't understand that if he looks at other women, anytime he looks at his wife, he's going to find something's wrong with her. Why? Because there's always something that somebody else has that you don't have. So if you look at other women, guess what? You're going to take the best of them. So she had nice hair, and she had nice eyes, and she had nice arms, and this and that. And then you look at your wife, and you look at all the chesronot, all the missing items. And they're looking their best, and your wife just came out of bed. She's just waking up. So what happens? It ruins a marriage. You're looking at other women, it ruins a marriage. Destroys a marriage. But it also ruins life in general. Why? Because the person that doesn't wash their eyes is always going to look at what his neighbor has. You know, there's an expression in English and say the grass is always greener on the other side. You know, the grass is green on the other side. It really isn't green on the other side. It's always green. It's green over there, it's green over here. But why does it seem like it's greener on the other side? Because once you start looking somewhere else, you forget what you have. You forget what you have home. You forget to appreciate what you have home. Hashem gave you a car, but you're looking at your neighbor's car. It's like, it's a ganav. Look at this thief. He has a brand new car. Yeah, but Habibi, you bought a brand new car 2 months ago. Why does he have to be a thief? He has a brand new car. You bought a new car 2 months ago. But you forgot you bought a new car 2 months ago. Why? Because he has a new car now. Says, this is a good enough. Look at his house. Look at his house, $1 million house. Yeah, but you live in a $2 million house. Why do you care he has $1 million house? What, is it taking money out of your pocket? What do you care he's living in a house? You're paying for it. People look at other people's stuff and they destroy their life. Why? Number one, first and foremost, they become ayin hara. They become a person that's not good to be next to. Second thing is, which is even worse, they give ayin hara to themselves. And third and worst, they're never ever going to be happy with what they have. Yosef HaTzadik never looked at what wasn't his. When Eshet Potiphar, the wife of Potiphar, told him, "No, come on, why don't you be with me?" He says, "What? I'm going to... Everything that the boss did for me, Potiphar did for me, he gave me a job, he gave me a house, he gave me everything. I'm going to go against him, steal his wife. You crazy?" So he didn't want to be a kfui tova. He didn't want to be ungrateful. But still, one day, the Gemara says, Torah says, that everybody left. The whole house left. It was a huge house. And everybody left. Nobody was there except Eshet Potiphar and Yosef HaTzadik. So the Gemara asks, wait a minute. How is it such a big house, so many servants, so many slaves? How is it that there's nobody home except Eshet Potiphar and Yosef? The Gemara says this was their holiday. The holiday of Avodah Zarah, like their Christmas, their Easter, their whatever, their Buddha holiday. So everybody went to worship their idol. And the wife of Potiphar pretended like she was sick. Why? She says, listen, I'm going to take my chance today. Today, I have him alone. I have Yosef alone. So she got Yosef alone, and Yosef, the Gemara says, almost sinned. He almost fell for it. Until the last second, he saw an image of his father. He saw an image of Yaakov Avinu, and Yaakov said to him, listen, if you touch her, you're not going to be one of the tribes. It's not going to be one of the tribes. It's not going to be Yosef, the tribe of Yosef. Nothing. Machuk, you're nothing. You become nothing. You become a gilgul of a dog. He'll come back as a dog. That's why a Jew that goes out with and touches a goya comes back as a gilgul, as a dog. Little pincher. Little pit bull, he comes back. That's what he says. You see some dogs roaming in the street, so you should say, maybe it's a little moshke from the last gilgul miskin. Why? He wanted to go out with the goya from the clubs. A person needs to know how dangerous it is. Yosef almost fell for it. But because he had zchut avot, his father came to him mamash in an image. But still, the urge was very strong. And the Gemara says that he took his hands and he dug them and he caused pain to himself, like broke his own fingers, in order to kill the urge. Because sometimes that's what you need to do. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai says in the Zohar, different ways that you could cool yourself off. One of the ways they used to do is they would actually burn themselves. Why? Because you can't have pleasure, and if you're a normal person, you can't have pain and pleasure at the same time. You don't need to do that if you do some of the other things that we can teach. You don't need to do any of this stuff. But the point is to just to show you how scared the Chachamim were of wasting seed, of doing something that's not allowed, that's forbidden in the eyes of Hashem. The same parasha also talks about Erve Onan. Because sometimes people think, oh no, see, this is only a problem for Jewish people. No, this is a problem also for Goyim too. Why? The time of Eren Onan, the sons of Yehuda, there's no Torah. There's just oral Torah. There's no written Torah. Written Torahs are hundreds of years later. Eren Onan, wasted seed, Hashem killed both of them. Hashem killed both of them. Then there's no second chance, third chance, fourth chance. They wasted seed. They looked at movies rated R. Finished. I don't need you in the world. Why? Because all of the good, which is called in Hebrew Shefa, that Hashem gives you, when a person wastes seed, when a person doesn't watch his Brit, he destroys it. Destroys it. All the good that Hashem gives you, he destroys. As if you're destroying everything good that I'm giving you. There's no point. There's no point. You're not going to fulfill your mission. So in this generation, we need a Yosef HaTzadik. Why? Because the problem of Tikkun HaBrit is everywhere. I'm telling you from experience, because we have, Baruch Hashem, hours, maybe, I don't know, 15, 20 hours worth of wasting seed, tikkun habrit, pgam habrit, shiurim on the internet. The most amount out of any English lectures that anybody else has in English language. There are a couple of other rabbis, Rav Mizrahi, Rav Zitron, that Rav Alon Anava, they spoke about it a little bit, but each have an hour, 15 minutes, 2 hours. Baruch Hashem, we had a whole series about it, Yishtabach Shimo. But because of that, and because it's so rare in the English language, people are very scared to say things. They're all politically correct. They'll say, oh, it's offensive. Why it's offensive? If it's Torah. What's offensive about it? It's Torah. Well, you're not going to know. One day you're going to know one way or another. You grow up. You realize you need to know what to do. Well, if you wait until you grow up to know what's going on, it's too late already. So this is why Hashem put it in Sefer Bereshit, in the beginning of the Torah. So the kids, the children, Be'kita Aleph, Be'et Gimel, already know what it is. That's what it was supposed to be. But because no one teaches it anymore, in English at least, many people, Avrechim, people from kolels, sometimes even rabbis, Talmidim, Yeshivot, secular people, Goyim, Noahites, all people from all over the world, contact us specifically about this. Why? It's a chidush for everybody. And people are realizing little by little that it's part of the reason why they have a disconnection with Hashem. Because this is one of the things that Hashem hates. Elokeim sone zima. HaKadosh Baruch Hu hates zima, hates immodesty, hates being wasteful with the shefa that we give him. Our body is not ours, really. We call it our body because we become comfortable with it. But how do we protect this brit? We have to learn from our avot. We have to learn from our avot. We have to learn to be strong like them. Rav Mazuz Shichye, maybe a few months ago, my rabbi told me, I had a lecture, and he said a story about a keila in Tripoli. And this keila had a family of giborim that would protect the Jews. They were strong people that would protect the Jews. And one day, the goyim didn't like this. The Arabs didn't like this. The British didn't like this. Why? Because all of the Jews were listening to these strong Jews, these giborim. So they decided to arrest everybody. Because they didn't want to work on Shabbat. They told them, listen, from now on you work on Shabbat. The gibor said to them, we're not working on Shabbat. We're not working on Shabbat. Yeah, but they're going to arrest, they're going to throw us in jail. Let us throw them in jail. Throw us in jail. Better we keep Shabbat and go to jail than we don't keep Shabbat. We have a problem with Hashem. Okay, so they arrested everybody. Mamash, the whole keila is in jail. And they see the British Rasha sees everybody's happy in jail. Miskinim, they're all happy in jail. Why? Because they're over there. They're in jail. They keep Shabbat. They see, you know what? There's only one problem. This whole keila has only one problem. Why this one gibo? His name is Gibri. His name is Gibri. He's the problem. He takes them out. Takes them out of the place. He says, I'm going to make an example out of you. If you don't tell them all to be Mechale Shabbat, I'm going to break every single bone in your body. He says, no problem, break. I'm not breaking Shabbat. The British guy left. He brought one of his Amalek soldiers that he has, went inside a cell with him. He told them, kill him. The British guy left, but the Arab guy, he knew Ghibli. He knew him. He knew he doesn't mess around. And Ghibli tells them, if you touch me, if you touch a hair on my body, you're not coming out of this cell alive. He says, yeah, but the general is going to kill me. You can kill me, or he's going to kill me. So at least pretend like I'm hitting you. He says, fine, I'll pretend. So he hits the wall, he says, ow. Hits the wall, he says, ow. So the general left, he released everybody. And then after that, there was a big bombing, a lot of people died. Ghibli was the hero, took all the bodies, buried everyone. Every day, he would come back from the place, from the bombing, with blood all over his body. Blood all over his body. Nobody else wanted to do it. But you have to do it. You have to bury the Jewish bodies. Somebody open the door. After he finished burying all the bodies, they were very, very poor. And one rich person, rich Jew, came to town, heard about this mitzvah. He came to him and he says, I'm willing to write a check. Whatever price you want, I just want to buy the mitzvah from you. Now, just so you understand, you have, Baruch Hashem, there's food over here. It's all good. It's all delicious. For Ghibli, they had one egg. One egg for the whole family. One egg for the whole family. But because his wife was pregnant, he gave it to his wife. He says, you eat. The rest of us are going to fast today. You eat. So somebody comes and he says, I'm going to give you any amount of money you want. Just give me this mitzvah. No one's going to know. Ghibli says, what do you think? I'm going to sell me mitzvah? You think I'm going to sell this mitzvah? These are my brothers. I'm burying my brothers. So you see, this Ghibli had strength. He wasn't a big Talmid Chacham. He wasn't he didn't write books. But he had emunah in Hashem, and he stood up for what was right. He kept Shabbat. He kept the Masoret. He didn't make any excuses. And years after he already left this world, one of the Gedolei Ador says a story about him. And the interesting thing is, I never knew this story until my rabbi told me. And why did my rabbi tell me this story out of all the stories? It's because it's our grandfather. Shtabach Shimolad. It's our grandfather. So the Gedolei Ador doesn't know it's our grandfather. He doesn't know who I am, Bechlal. Actually, he answered one of our questions. But it's our grandfather. Why? Because the previous generation stood for something. Stood for something. We stood for something. You have to think about it. As a Jew, you have to think about it. If you're not going to keep Torah 100%, not 50, not 60, 100%. There's no such thing as like 50-50. There's no such thing. It's either you keep or you don't keep. There's no like, oh no, he's a half a religious. There's no such thing. You go to Shammai and say, oh yeah, yeah. Is Tzvika the half religious guy? There's no such thing. Is the guy where half of the things he did were averot, half of the things he did were mitzvot. Okay, we pay him for the averot, we pay him for the mitzvot, but the averot, unfortunately, have a very, very big payment. So until we get to the mitzvot, maybe a few thousand years. Why? So a person needs to know, for you to be here today, Am Yisrael has been sacrificing their life for 3,330 years. Moshe Rabbeinu sacrificed his life, Parashat Ki Tisa, he says, Hashem, erase me from your book if you're going to touch Am Yisrael. Why? All they did to him is curse him and embarrass him and go against him. If I was Moshe Rabbeinu, I say, Hashem, you know what? You have a good idea. Maybe we should start something new. Why? All they do is complain. All they do is go against you, Hashem. You know what? Let's just start something new. But that's why I'm not Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu says, no, Hashem, you're going to touch them? Kill me first. After Moshe Rabbeinu, you have Yeshua ben Nun. Then you have all the Nevi'im, you have the Skenim, you have the Tanaim, the unbelievable Masoret. But if you read the Gemara, you look at Masechet Gittin, you look at Masechet Brachot, you look at all of the Gemarot, you see that every Gemara talks about how much suffering Am Yisrael had to go through in order to be Jewish. But not half a Jew. Not sometimes a Jew and sometimes a Goy. Always a Jew and always proud of it. You're going to read Megillat Esther soon. Megillat Esther says, "Is Mordechai Ish HaYehudi, this is a Jew. How do they know he's a Jew? The Ben Yisrael, the grandfather of Rav Zeev, he says, why? Because his prayers were so big, you can see it from far away that he was a Jew. Mordechai was a proud Jew. He wasn't like embarrassed to be a Jew, so he was wearing Goyish clothes. He was proud to be a Jew. He was walking around with his Gemara all the time. He was walking around with his Sfarim all the time. He was telling people, I'm going to learn Torah. I'm not going to play basketball. He was proud to be a Jew. You have Mordechai. You have all of the Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva, his whole life, 40 years of his life, didn't hate the Torah. Then he understood what Torah is. He loved Torah after that for 80 years. 80 years he sacrificed his life for Am Yisrael. At the end of his days, they killed him in a very vicious way. And his Talmidim says, Rabbeinu, why don't you say the Shem Meforash, kill everybody here with the holy name. He says, I have an opportunity to make one mitzvah now that I never made in my life. To die on Kiddush Hashem, to say, Hashem, I love you with my life too, my soul. I never been able to do this mitzvah. Now you want me to ruin it for what? By saving myself a few more years? So you see, Rabbi Akiva understood the value of a mitzvah. It's worth to die for a mitzvah. Rav Zilber, Alav HaShalom, wrote in his amazing book called To Remain a Jew. He says about a Chabadnik at the time of the Holocaust, they made him undress, took off all of his clothes. And then all he left on was his tzitzit. He says, take off your tzitzit. He says, I'm not taking off my tzitzit. He goes, take off your tzitzit, I'm going to kill you. He says, kill me. Kill me, I'm not taking off the tzitzit. Yeah, but you took off all the rest of your clothes. He goes, yeah, the rest of the clothes are meaningless. A tzitzit I don't take off. Why? It comes with me to Olam Haba. He goes, why? He goes, because this tzitzit is my agreement with Hashem Yitbarach that he's going to take revenge on my blood against you. That's the tzitzit. He's willing to die for a tzitzit. Am Yisrael has been willing to die for the Torah for 3,330 years. Now you have to ask yourself a question. If we decide we don't feel like being Jewish, like the Torah says, so now one day, after 120 or sooner, we're all going to go there. We're going to go to Shemayim. And they're going to have a Bet Din in Shemayim. Moshe, Aharon, David, Shlomo, Avraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. They're going to be there. My grandfathers are going to be there. And say, wait a minute. Look how much we suffered for you to be a Jew. For 3,000 years we suffered for you to be a Jew. This one sacrificed his life. This one sacrificed all of his money. This one this. This one. Everybody sacrifices life. And you decide you don't feel like you want it to be secular. You decided you wanted to be a goy. Why? Why'd you ruin it? 3,000 years stops with you. Think about it. You're going to go up to Shammai and say, wow, 3,000 years, they're all celebrating. Am Yisrael Chai, Am Yisrael Chai, Am Yisrael Chai. Then this little Moshke is coming to Shammai and says, oh, no more Am Yisrael, ended at Moshke. Why? He didn't want to be a Jew anymore. He wanted to be a goy. He wanted to go to the casino. He wanted to go to the beach. He wanted to go play basketball. He didn't want to go to the kollel. He didn't want to go to yeshiva. He didn't want to keep Shabbat. So it ended with him. So you're going to get up to Shammai, you're going to meet Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu says, why'd you do this to me? What did I do to you? 3,000 years I fought for you to be a Jew. Why'd you ruin it? What are you going to say to him? Oh, I had desires. What do you think? He didn't have desires. I wanted to have fun. What do you think? They didn't want to have fun. What do you think? Torah is not fun. In this generation, we have to find a way to connect to our avot. We have to find a way to overcome desires. We have to find a way to constantly remind ourselves of why, what we're fighting for. What we're fighting for. What's the point of all of it? That's what we talked about yesterday. What is the point of all of it? But to have righteous kids, it can't just be because of our avot. It also has to be because of the parents here. The Gemara says a story about a woman by the name of Kimchit. Kimchit had 8 children, all of them Kohanim Gdolim. Every kid Kohen Gadol. The Tanaim came to her and said, Rebbetzin, new helper, how? All your kids? Okay, one kid's Gdol Ador, fine. 2 kids, fine. All of them tzadikim, all of them Kohanim Gdolim. How? What's the secret? What do you feed these kids? She says, never in my life did the walls of my house see one hair on my head. My whole life, the walls in my house, not the neighbors, not the Shekhinah. Not the Shechina, not the neighbor. The walls of my house never saw my hair. She would have somebody with a sheet, a bed sheet, cover her so she could take off a kisui rosh. Why? So the walls don't see. Maybe there's neshamot in the walls, come back in a gilgul. Maybe somebody's peeking from somewhere else. Maybe it's going to make her comfortable with herself too much. She says, modesty is so important for a woman, I didn't even want to be comfortable with myself. Because I didn't become too comfortable myself and I protected myself and no one saw my immodesty, no one saw my hair, Hashem gifted me tzaddikim kids. You can read Tehillim from here to next year, but if you go to the beach every other day, guess what? Nothing's going to, Tehillim is not going to help. You're better off to take Tehillim, throw him in the, leave him in the beach. Leave the Tehillim in the beach and you stay home. It's better. The point is, Rabotai, you have to have teamwork. The father has to learn Torah. The mother has to teach it to the kids. Why? It's not easy in this world. There's a lot of tavod, a lot of desires, a lot of problems. The parents have to be strong. Strong for the kids until the kids are strong enough to do it themselves. Be'ezrat Hashem, if we can connect to Avotenu HaKadoshim, to the ones that are in the books, and the ones that we remember in our life just 10, 20 years ago, and take their strength, their Torah, their Masoret, and remind ourselves that if we do it right, we go to the same place as them. That's eternity of good. If we don't, they're going to see us. They're going to say, why did you ruin it? Do you really want to be the one that ruins it? 3,000 years of history? No one wants to be the loser. No one wants to be the one that ruins everything. So just remember, Torah and mitzvot is not just something to do. It's what kept Am Yisrael Jewish. Without Torah and mitzvot, there's no Judaism. All of the kofrim, all of the heretics, whether the Sadducees, Dukim, Dusim, all of the Reform, all of the Karaites, all of these Reshaim, there's no memory of them. They don't exist anymore. There's new versions of them, but the originals don't exist anymore. The Greeks, the Romans, the Turks, the Nazis, all of those, the originals are all gone. All that's left is Am Yisrael. But the only part of Am Yisrael that continues to survive is the religious ones. Why? Because the non-religious eventually become goyim. Eventually they become goyim. One generation, finished. So always remember, if you're a parent, your kids are copycats. They're going to do a little bit less than you. A little bit less than you. That's just the way it works. Yeridat adorot. You're going to talk business on Shabbat, they're going to work on Shabbat. You're going to wear like a half a modest skirt, they're not going to wear a skirt at all. They're going to wear jeans or shorts. You're going to cover the hair. Sometimes they're not going to cover hair at all. They're always going to do a little less. This is what a parent needs to think about. So if you do a little more, guess what? Even if they do a little less, they're still going to be okay. They're still going to be okay. Be'ezrat Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives Yosef a tzaddik a lot of bracha, a lot of atzlacha, chayim arukim, shlemim, eleim Torah, mitzvot, gmiut chasadim, gives his mom a lot of strength, Baruch Hashem, and his father a lot of strength, as a keta rabim, to continue being a eshet chayil, Be'ezrat Hashem, that takes care of the kids, teaches them mamash, day and night. You look at the kids, Baruch Hashem, they know a lot, Baruch Hashem. They know Torah, they know mitzvot, and they're all little. It has nothing to do with me. I, Baruch Hashem, I work for Hashem constantly. I'm always out or I'm learning. Everything is Baruch Hashem, my wife. Why? She's constantly with him, and she knows if Torah and mitzvot is not ingrained into the kids day and night, from morning to night, all day, we're not going to hold up. We're not going to hold up, and then we're going to be the ones that ruined it. We don't want to be the ones that ruined it. So Be'ezrat Hashem, we have a lot of strength to raise more kids, Be'ezrat Hashem, with Torah, mitzvot, Milut Chasadim, Be'ezrat Hashem, v'shakadosh Baruch Hu yivarech otchem. Thank you again for coming. Tiskul mitzvot. Be'ezrat Hashem, la l'bracha v'atzlacha.
Amen.
רבים נעשו לזימון הסתרה. הישלח מלאך לפניך ניצב על יד ימינך, ורבנים לבניך יהיו סביב שולחנך. הישלח מלאך לפניך ניצב על יד ימינך, בן פורת יוסף ובן פורת עליין, בן פורת יוסף בן 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 פורת עליין.
I want only to say one word. Like, מה זה בן פורת יוסף בן פורת עליין? What's this? We say בן פורת יוסף בן פורת עליין. פירוש אחד, פורת יוסף, what is this פורת יופי? אז אומר, בן פורת יוסף בן פורת עליין. It's nice to see יוסף הצדיק, כמו שאמר הרב ירון, הוא היה מאוד יפה תואר ויפה מראה. אבל יש another פירוש, כמו שהגמרא שם עומד בברכות נ"ה עמוד ב', בן פורת יוסף בן פורת עליין. ומעל העין, העין הרע לא שולטת למה? בעיגול הרוב בקרב הארץ, שעין הרע לא שולטת בג'לירשן של יוסף הצדיק. אז העניין של יוסף, הגמרא גם אומר, אדם שלא רוצה שישלוט בו עין הרע, יגיד את המילים האלה, בן פורת יוסף, בן פורת עליין, ועיגול הרוב בקרב, אדם מזרעד יוסף, בן פורת יוסף, בן פורת עליין, ועיגול הרוב בקרב הארץ. כמו יוסף הצדיק שלא שתה בעינה בישה, כך אני זרעי לא ישלוט בנו עין הרע, בעזרת השם, בעזרת השם שיזכו לגדל את יוסף הצדיק, יוסף השם עליכם ככם אלף פעמים מרצון, אמן. אני הייתי טיפת מים רק לעשות מים אחרונה.
כן. טיפה, לא משנה, אפשר את הכוס טעור, יש פה מים. טיפה מחילה, מחילה מסון, מחילה. קיצור, ספרו לי, טיפה.